At this time, I would like to recognize the DM worker of the week. And it's a young lady this time, and her name is, for some reason, it's not showing by there. That's why I was looking around. Miss Lily Bunch. I'm going to ask Caitlin if she will run up and grab a gift certificate, giving everyone, the worker of the week, a gift certificate for $25 from somewhere or another.
And she's
in Children's Church, and that's what she does, helping out. That's a really good picture of her. Again, thank all of you for being here today. I'm going to invite the ushers up as they get ready to serve us. Thank all of you for being obedient. I just had a counseling session with a young couple getting ready to get married in just a few short weeks. And that's one of the things that we spoke about, was our responsibility to the Lord in our giving of our tithe and our offering. And we thank you for understanding that and being obedient in that. And if you don't understand the need, please get with me at some point in time soon. I'm going to ask that, Chris, if you would say a blessing over the offering. Savior, holy Lamb, standing O for you, Johnny. Nice. Johnny. Thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus, right? Thank you, Jesus. Like we all, Johnny has a testimony, and that's what we will hear today and in a few minutes. Young man is going to share his testimony, but that's a miracle that you guys just saw. That's a miracle,
yes.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to tell just burn up 45 seconds of your life right now, but I'm telling a little bit about Johnny. You know, Johnny is a talented person. Man knows how to play the guitar, probably several instruments. You're okay working with wood as well, Johnny, you know, I would say, you know. It's like, you're okay. You're okay. Yeah. But he said learning to play the violin is probably the most difficult thing he's ever done in his life. We know that he's been delivered from drug addiction, and he said that was nothing compared to the challenge of trying to play this thing. But just wanted to love on you a little bit. But hey, it's time for us to come together, thank the Lord for his goodness in corporate prayer, bring our needs, our petitions to him. I've got several requests here written down, and I'm going to ask them.
Because you first loved us, we thank you. We thank you for your price, the price, Lord, that you paid for each one of us, Lord.
When he came for me,
While Miss Joyce plays, can we just spend the next few minutes? Let's just thank Him that He never gave up on us, but He kept running after us. Hallelujah. When we were trying to run, He ran faster. Hallelujah. And He held on to us. Lord, I just thank You, Lord, this morning, God. Hallelujah, Lord, that You didn't let me go. Hallelujah. Lord, that You didn't let me outrun You, Lord. Hallelujah, but You came to me, Lord, in the place that I was. Oh, Lord, hallelujah. No matter the mess, oh, God, no matter the situation, God, You were there. Hallelujah. Lord, and You caught me, Lord, and You embraced me, Lord, and You loved me, Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus, You saved me. Hallelujah. Into eternity. Lord, we just thank You, Lord, this morning for Your love for us, oh, Lord, this morning. Hallelujah. We thank You for that love today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, which is a love, oh, God, that we can't even begin to understand. We can't even begin to fathom this morning, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank You for this love, Lord, which never leaves us and never forsakes us. Hallelujah. No matter where we go, no matter what we're doing, Lord, You're there. Hallelujah. Lord, we just praise You, God. Hallelujah. We praise You. Hallelujah. Lord, we just praise You, God. Hallelujah, Lord. We just thank You, Lord. Hallelujah. Let Your sacrifice, let Your sacrifice, let Your sacrifice raise up, oh God, in this house. Hallelujah. Let Your thanksgiving raise up in this house. Let Your praise, hallelujah, rise up in this place this morning. Hallelujah. Lord, you have not completed the work yet, but Lord, they're in the process, oh Lord, and we thank you, God, for that miracle, oh God, of being moved from darkness to light, Lord. We thank you for the miracle of healing, Lord, today, God, in our bodies, God, in our souls, oh God. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you do not give up, Lord. Hallelujah on us. Hallelujah. We give ourselves, oh God, to you, Lord, today. We're here, Lord, to offer ourselves, Lord, as a living sacrifice, oh Lord, to you today. Lord, use us, oh Lord, so we can help others, oh God, bringing them out of darkness, oh God. Give ourselves, oh Lord, to you, Lord. And I give myself away.
Life is not my own. To you I belong.
myself, give myself to you.
Hazel, just a moment or two as we were singing. You got a nice looking clan, Miss Hazel. I don't know if she can even hear me or not, but you look good. Hazeline and your crew, it looks really nice. It's good to see all of you guys. I'm going to, invite a new face, but for some is a familiar name and face. I would ask as I'm introducing this man that you would pray for him. I was thinking at the time we were taking requests of corporate prayer, he was probably praying for himself, like, God, calm my nerves down, calm my nerves down. But I'm going to ask John Fraley if he would come up. Y'all can give him a hand clap. I'll keep on talking. I'm not going to tell any of the story, but this is a very close friend of mine, and he called me one day, and we've talked several times, but he called me one day, and I'm going to just leave it at that. Just my close friend, John Fraley, please make him feel welcome one more time.
Fierce. Jeez. Okay. Right here. All right. started being abused by my older brother in a sexual manner. And that went on for about, I realized this wasn't supposed to be going on. But when I was going to tell my parents, they were going through a separation, and I was like, well, this is just going to push that over the edge. It's a guaranteed divorce then. So I never said anything. I just kind of pushed it to the side. And he actually went to prison for something else, so it kind of saved me in that manner. But I started hanging around the wrong crowd and doing drugs very young. I was 11, 12, started off, you know, soft stuff, just smoking marijuana and stuff like that. But it eventually just kept spiraling out of control and getting worse and worse. And I realized that when I was on drugs, I didn't think about what had happened to me. And it was just kind of a band-aid, I guess, or I thought it was. I ended up getting married, and that may have helped out a lot. I got sober at certain points in my life, but could never just really hold on to it. And it was October 14th, 2014. I got the phone call that my mom had killed herself. And me and my mom were really close. You know, it was, she was like a best friend to me. I could tell her anything. She was always there for me. So to actually hear that news, even though I felt it coming, I seen it coming, you know, and she had tried multiple times. I had to go to the hospital to pick her up and stuff, but it still just really struck in her. And after that, I started spiraling out of control. I mean, I was doing whatever I could get my hands on, basically, to not feel anymore. And then it's about 4 months after that, I started going through a divorce, which didn't help anything. It was just like one thing after another. And I had this misconception of God. I felt like I was being punished for something. I felt like I had done something wrong my whole life, and he's just like, well, this is going to happen to you, and this is going to happen to you. And it was one day I was about ready to commit suicide. I was there. I always told myself, like, even after my mom did it, I was like, I'd never do that. I'd never, you know, put my kids through what she put me through. But at that point in my life, I was over it. You know, I couldn't deal with this addiction anymore. I couldn't deal with hurt. I couldn't deal with hurting the people I was hurting. But I randomly got a text message from Walter. And it was just the simplest text that I would blow off most of the times from other people. And it was just, hey, how are you doing? And man, it was easy to lie from where I was at in my life, you know. But at that time, I couldn't do it. I was just like, I need help. So I finally asked for help and was ready to go to rehab. And Walter helped me get there along with Jordan Bradley. He helped me get there. And I'd always straddled the fence on going to church and actually, I mean, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed the theory of it, but I never truly had felt or believed, I guess you could say. But I ended up going to a Christian-based rehab program. And I think when we figured it out, of all the church services that we went to, it was 5 years of church in 3 months. And that was a good dose of it, that's for sure. But I'd seen some miracles in that place. Guys that were atheists, you know, just didn't want nothing to do with it. You know, shaken to the core and on the ground in tears, you know, just guys you wouldn't see. And it really has changed my life in so many different ways. Obviously, I wouldn't have never been caught speaking in a church before all this. I feel like I'm going to vomit right now, honestly. But I was laying in bed one night, just kind of going over my testimony in my mind. Because somebody had told me while I was in the rehab program that that's the one thing the devil can't take from you, is your testimony. mind. And it just kept saying, the little voice in the back of my head was like, go to Happy Home. You need to go to Happy Home and just give me your testimony. And I don't know if it's for me or if it's for somebody else. You know, maybe you know somebody that's dealing with some of the issues that I did. It might need someone to talk to. I mean, I would love to help somebody as I've been helped. Or if it's for me, you know, being able to stand up here so when I look what I came through, I'll know I'm in a better place now. You know, and it'll help me keep on the straight and narrow. I mean, I just, without God, I don't know where I'd be today. And without that text message, randomly, I don't know where I'd be. So, that's all I have to say. And just, thank y'all for listening. And this young lady in the back with a pretty little girl, that's my fiance, Amber. He just reminded me. I had called Walter because I was laying in bed, like I was saying, and I couldn't sleep. The first night, it was like, hey, go to Happy Home and give your testimony. And I was like, eh, I'll be okay. I don't really like public speaking, you know. So I kind of pushed it off. Didn't sleep that whole night. The next night, same thing. It was like, go to Happy Home, give your testimony. I'm just like, eh, I'll pass on that. I'm just going to keep on going. But after about the third night of not sleeping, I was like, man, I guess I'm going to go to Happy Home and give my testimony. So I called Walter. And it was actually, I got sick the first time. I was supposed to come 2 or 3 weeks ago, and I got sick. And I was like, oh my goodness. So last night, I got the worst case of food poisoning I've ever gotten. I feel horrible right now. But I was like, if I do not get this done, I don't know what's going to happen. So I'm going to go ahead and get up there and speak. Feeling better now, a little flustered. But thank y'all once again.
Praise God.
Thank you.
It's beautiful how God works in people's lives, right? Been thinking about, I've known John's been trying to get here for a while. And, I didn't know if it was his nerves the first time, him not being able to be here, but it's, you know, it's beautiful how we're prompted by the Holy Spirit, and we've just got to follow through on that.
Yeah.
And I was thinking about just the, and everybody, I mentioned it earlier, everybody has a testimony. If we're willing to, we have it, you know, it's our responsibility to share it. And not all of us do that. But, some testimonies are more colorful, if you will. We mentioned Johnny Dale, and just the beautiful stories that how God touches our life, and what seems so dark at one moment can bring newness and life that comes forth, right? And we all have different ones, different storylines, and how the Lord has seen fit to come into our lives. Maybe how you see somebody taking the Bible at a beach, and you just never know how these small things will change our life forever. And we're just talking in Journey class about how, you know, we all have a sphere of influence, and our responsibility is to be salt and light all the time. It's not like left foot. I have. I want to make sure I don't want to embarrass myself. Left foot in, you know, left foot out. You have to stay all in all the time. You can't be chameleons. Chris Bradley put something on the board or the message board or the sign today, and I felt like I needed to give something to go along with what he put out there. Chris, I'm picking on you, man. But it's launch time, and it's on that sign. I want to give just a real quick few words here. This message or this sermonette will provide really as an announcement to our church family. So if you would, please turn to Luke chapter 5. John, thank you for being here. It's not by accident. I believe the Holy Spirit tapped you on the shoulder that night and said, for whatever reason, it was this place, you know. And it's kind of funny as you're turning. I love the sound of the paper turning, but he was just telling me, he says, on Sunday, we're just in church all day long. And I think y'all go to three different services a lot of times. So, but we're super happy to see you guys this morning. Luke chapter 5. Launch time. So it was, as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out from the land. And what was going on, the crowd was actually pushing him kind of hard, and he so large, I don't believe the people really could hear him well. But I think, in my opinion, this is when probably the first, not stadium, but the first time, I believe he used the water to help transfer his voice so the congregation and the multitudes could hear him. But they had put out from the shore just a little ways so he could speak. But he said, then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon Peter's, and asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the book. And when he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." But Simon answered and said to him, "Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your words, I will let down your net," or "let down the net." And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. And so they signaled to their partners in the boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. Then Simon Peter saw it. He fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on you will catch men." So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for the sweetness of the Spirit that's in our hearts and even in our atmosphere today. And God, we ask that you just bless the reading of your word. God, we just ask that we would communicate well. We thank you for life. We thank you for testimony. And we just thank you for your love and your grace and your peace. We thank you for your peace today. We thank you for your calling today. Much about what this story is about. We thank you for your calling upon men and upon women. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. This story, this short story, is recorded in the other Gospels as well, Matthew and Mark, but it's just kind of a snippet of the story. We don't get much of the narrative. But here in Luke, we get kind of the full picture. And this is the true calling of some of the disciples. And it speaks about not all the translations. I was reading this recently, and I saw the word launch, and it just kind of spoke to me, and I just wanted to share just a bit about the story, and then make an announcement to the church here. I've had one experience, just one, of fishing in a boat with a net. Now, I've been fishing, you know, rod and reel, that sort of thing. I'm not an avid fisherman like some. I don't hit all the local ponds. I know there's a couple of you in here that catch and release and all that good stuff. But has anybody ever been like, no, I'm not talking about herring dipping. I'm talking about in the river. And we can't do it any longer, but how many of you have ever been in the river fishing with a net before? Handful? Okay. All right. Nice. I had an opportunity to do that. I was actually probably 16 or 17. I went out with Wilbur Ray and Keith one day. And it was a slow day. I didn't know that, but it was to be a slow day. We did not catch very much, but I still remember it quite well. And the thing that stuck in my mind was I remember pulling the nets in. And even though I just didn't know really how to do it, but I was thinking, I couldn't do this very long. Because it was a lot of tug to the netting. And it really was, I was thinking, it's still in my mind. I mean, I was struggling, you know, in shape, probably 16, 17 years old. And I was really struggling to get the net in, and it wasn't hardly any fish. I was thinking, oh, Lord, if this thing was full of herring, I don't know what I would do. But it's funny how things kind of stick in your mind. But the thought of you know, fishing and the proper way to handle your net, and it was just new to me. And if I went out now, I probably would still struggle because I don't really know how to, I guess, retrieve the net properly. But I was thinking, you know, in this storyline, you know, what seemed like such an ordinary day, you know, they'd gone out, you know, I'm sure they had done it before. The gentleman I went, was a fisherman, farmer from Rocky Hop. I'm sure he had been out before and didn't catch many fish. But it would get old to me real quick because I remember fishing. Ramona's not here today, but Braxton, he could like fish with a rod and reel like all day long and not catch anything, you know. And I'm just not that way. I'd lose interest really quick. And but I was thinking about this ordinary day when the what would be disciples, they weren't disciples yet, but would be disciples launched out, fished all night, came back in, and they're just going through the grind. They're retrieved their nets, washing them off. That was that's the proper thing to do. Mend your nets, wash them, you know, clean them, and then go fishing again. But wow, what? This was to be not an ordinary day, but a supernatural day. You guys know the storyline of how I was thinking about this recently. This would be at least two articles in our newspaper. It would be a record catch of fish story, right? It was breaking the nets. And the harvest, the catch was so large that they actually had to beckon others to come and help, right? It was, that's a really beautiful, teamwork, and, you know, working the net together to get the harvest in. But then the crazy thing is, it says they forsook all. So it would be like, it don't say they went into retirement, that they had, you know, all these fish and they sold them and everything. It said they got to the shore. I'm sure, I don't know if they just gave them away. I don't know if, but all these things I ponder. If they just left them with their family, because they forsook all and they followed Christ. And this was the, at least for, you know, a small portion of them, this was the when they decided to follow Christ. And it was, he chose fishermen. He could have chosen anybody. He could have went to the temple, right? He could have gotten religious people, but he got the ordinary people to help from an ordinary day of fishing to changing the world. Yes. An ordinary day of fishing. They didn't know what was, you know, a natural day. Just seemed like everything was normal, right? To something supernatural taking place. What seemed so normal, little did they know, and I'd say maybe little do we know, what seems so mundane can just so quickly change to something supernatural. You see, we're still talking about this fishing story. 2017, we're still talking about it. Isn't that amazing? Recently, somebody sent me a text message, and if you get 20 extra minutes, check this out. It was actually yesterday. And it was a commencement address of a commander from the Navy SEALs. He was dressed up, Brother Red, I don't know what you call it, but he was dressed in white. I mean, he had his hat on during the commencement, but he was decked. And had several bars up here. I mean, he was high up in the ranks, and he was speaking to the graduates.
Class A uniform.
Class A uniform.
Best uniform.
Okay, he was like he was looking good, and he shared several stories of the SEALs and their requirements to get to become a SEAL. And he spoke about how, you know, all the I would say trials, all the testing, all the pushing, and some of them just they're not cut out. And he says, all you got to do is go ring that bell. And if you go ring that bell, you can all the suffering and the testing, you know, you can just quit. And you can go home, but you won't become a SEAL. But one of the things he spoke about was that one of the exercises was they would break up in teams in a boat, and it was on the Pacific coast. Some call it the left coast, but the waves are pretty large, and it's hard to like get beyond the break of the waves because they're so large. And he spoke about how not very momentous times where folks would just spill over and get, you know, they'd try again. There would be six on the team plus the point, which is called, I believe, a coxswain or a coxswain. I'm not for sure. I just heard that yesterday. Never heard the word before. But he said the key was that the team had to row together. Now at the point sound, that person says stroke, if you're one of the six, you better be digging in and pulling the stroke. And then stroke, and he said if one person was just not in rhythm, he said every time the boat's gonna capsize, everybody spills out, and it's chilly, cold water. And so that was the test. But this is what he boiled it down to this. He said, and he had like seven or eight points, but this is one thing that he said. He said, if you're going to change the world, find some people that you row the boat with. If you're going to change the world, you better find some people that'll row your boat with you. And I just started, I was already thinking about this launching story with the disciples and everything. And I just want to tell you, I appreciate the ones that's in this congregation that can hear the sound of my voice that is trying to row a boat to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ in this neighborhood, in our surrounding communities, and our surrounding counties. I appreciate you rowing the boat. But if we want to change the world, we got to row the boat together. And my mind went, some days the days may seem so normal and so ordinary, but what extraordinary things can be accomplished when we say, but God. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing when somebody's life, I didn't know the deal about the text message. I know we had texted, but I didn't know that was some breaking moment. I had no clue. But we don't know. We don't know. We're just a little function of the Holy Spirit following up with somebody's mind just randomly goes through your mind. Maybe it's not so random. Maybe it's not so random. But it's a connection of you and the Holy Spirit needing to help somebody in a situation. I'm telling you, we have a cloak of Isaiah 61 upon us. And if I'm not going into that scripture, if you don't know what Isaiah 61, you need to look it up. Because that's part of your calling. And I can point, and I probably know all of you by name, at least most by name, but I believe that's part of who we are. But if we want to change the world, find somebody to row the boat with you. Wow. And this fishing story is certainly, it did change the world for sure. One other thing I wanted to pull out from this scripture. I don't know when it said Peter told him that to launch out. Where did he say launch out to?
To the deep.
To the deep, right? Now, I don't know really what that means. I don't know if they were fishing closer to the shoreline and Christ said, hey, let's go out a little bit further than where they were fishing at. But what was Peter's thought, do you think? What was Peter's thought in that moment when he said, hey, Simon, let's go out to the deep and then let down your net. He did say, hey, we've toiled all night, right? That's what most translations say. We've worked all night already, but at your word. Now, Christ didn't say, hey, let's go fishing. That's not what he said. It says, let down your net for a catch. There's a difference between fishing and catching, right? If somebody said yes, yeah, for sure, right? I like catching. Now, I don't know what Peter's thought process was. I don't know if he realized, man, you're a carpenter and you're trying to tell me what to do about fishing. What is this? But he had seen the miracles of Jesus at your word, right? But I just recently heard somebody say, there's no way to be awestruck near the shoreline. You're always on the water. The awestruckness, if I can make that word up, you're awestruck always in the deep. And how many's been like offshore before, like 30, 40 miles out? The water's different out there. And it's beautiful. But in this storyline, they launched into the deep. And with what took place, Simon Peter, was awestruck at what took place. Now please catch this. What seems so mundane again, the storyline changed because it was a supernatural thing. Now I've come to a time where I want to just kind of make an announcement. And again, if I was going to, I'm not real big on sermon titles, but if I title this, I would say it's launch time. So there's a couple things I want to announce, and you'll be hearing more about this. And something we're excited about. And may we be, as Peter, may we be awestruck at a launch. On April the 2nd and April the 9th, that's the first two Sundays of April, not very far away. And, let me start with this. This is the next Sunday. Bishop Burton will be with us. And next Sunday, we'll be doing something special also. What will that be? Next Sunday, we will be... Praise God. We're taking up an offering for Ukraine to plant at least one church. I believe we can exceed one. I do believe that. All right, so the first Sunday and the second Sunday of April, I'm going to be speaking about the early church and the ministry and the multiplication of the early church. And what that leads up to, third Sunday is what? The third Sunday of April is what? Easter, Resurrection Sunday. It's a crescendo note for Christendom. And that week, we're going to launch something that we haven't done before, that I know of. And then my mind went to something I have not asked anybody. Cottage prayer meetings, right? Cottage prayer meetings. My mind went to that the other day, so maybe this is not a first. But on the week of April the 16th, we're going to launch home groups out of Happy Home. We've already contacted host families. We've already contacted facilitators. And this, we're launching out. And what our plans are, we're going to, this first session will be for 8 weeks. And then in June, we'll pull back and we will go through, normal scheduled services. And then in fall, we'll launch again into another, the fall session of home groups. And on April the 2nd and April the 9th, we will have what we call sign-up Sundays. And we will have, after the services, we'll have the host group and the facilitators here. If they've been notified, if they can't be here, we're going to have a photo of them to make sure everybody knows who the person is. And we'll be meeting on different nights of the week. And this will, I believe, dovetail. We've been speaking with Ms. Joyce about Young at Heart and how this just fits real beautiful with that. I mean, it's not a home group, but it's a beautiful group. And so we're looking at, ways to enhance the Young at Heart. Now, certainly I'm not trying to say that our home groups, our seniors cannot participate. We're certainly not saying that. The more the merrier. But we will be launching that Easter week, and we're going to run for 8 weeks. Now, with that comes, we will not be beginning Easter week. We will not be having Wednesday night services at this church for 8 weeks. Now, so at session one, Resurrection or Easter week, we'll run for 8 weeks. No Wednesday night services here. And then after the 8 weeks, throughout the summer, we'll have Wednesday nights like we normally do. Okay? That's one thing I wanted to announce. Second thing I wanted to announce is that I've been communicating with some area pastors, and